That's not just a man on a ledge. That's a man on a ledge re-released in retrofitted 3D. So now if you want to watch him commit suicide, you have to pay extra for it. This is Movie Night. Hello and welcome to Movie Night, YouTube's weekly interactive movie review show. I'm your host, Jonathan Paula. Tonight in the program, we'll be taking a look at two films currently playing nationwide in theaters. One new film and one old one. We'll start off with Man on a Ledge. Released on January 27th, this film opened in fifth place with a disappointing $8 million take on opening day. And despite some fun moments, it's unlikely to ever bank a huge profit. Sam Worthington stars as an ex-cop, apparently prepared to jump from the top floor of New York's Roosevelt Hotel, but it isn't necessarily because he wants to die. The story that unfolds over the next 102 minutes, told through occasional use of flashbacks, is a rather ridiculous, if entertaining one. Much of the excitement and mystery from this action thriller comes from deciphering the clues of the bizarre plot, like in this scene when Worthington suspects his former partner, Anthony Mackie, is part of a conspiracy.
Why don't you come on off this ledge?
Oh, I can't do that.
Don't be crazy, Cass. Come in here.
Okay! Let me help you.
I always wondered if you were involved in this.
Involved in what?
There is someone talking to IA right now. Whose name are they gonna come up with?
I'm your friend. Take my hand.
Whose name?
What the hell are you doing?
Go.
Get away
from go.
Me!
Go, go, go.
Take him.
I'm your friend! Then why do you look so guilty?
Ed Harris and Ed Burns deliver some decent supporting performances here, but Elizabeth Banks is curiously miscast as a gruff crisis negotiator who honestly just feels like she's outside of her element the entire time. After becoming an A-lister overnight with the success of Avatar, Worthington does a great job bringing character and emotion to this empty motion picture, but his performance is muddled by the bloated writing and constant exposition. Considering a majority of this film is spent watching a man literally teeter on the edge of death, Man on a Ledge is surprisingly devoid of any real tension. Although rarely believable, there's no question this is a fast and exciting film, but the sense of danger or urgency is sorely missing from a film that unfortunately tries to be much more than its premise, and ultimately comes up short. For those looking for a decently made thriller that never quite delivers everything it promises, but never outright fails either, there are certainly worse ways to spend an hour and a half. Man on a Ledge. Not suspenseful, yet preposterously entertaining. Well, there's my review, now let's read some of yours from the YouTube comments. In comes the Redomatic to show us our scores for Man on a Ledge. A 6 and a 7. Those of you who have already seen this film in theaters had a decidedly mixed opinion on it. Some thought it was awesome and suspenseful, while others criticized the convoluted plot and uninspired execution, with your scores averaging to a cool. The factor facts here will help illustrate the nuances of my review, which despite some of the setbacks in the story and believability areas, was a quick and enjoyable film that smartly doesn't overstay its welcome. I thought it was good. Now let's talk about Star Wars Episode I, The Phantom Menace. Originally released in May of 1999 as the first of three prequels to the iconic Star Wars trilogy from 20 years prior, this sci-fi fantasy epic is poised to eventually break the $1 billion box office mark with its most recent 3D re-release, making it only the 11th film of all time to ever do so. Before he was the bona fide superstar he is today, Liam Neeson was still a well-respected character actor, who stars as a wise and skilled Jedi Knight alongside his eager apprentice, Ewan McGregor, on a mission to protect Natalie Portman, the queen of a peaceful utopian planet, and uncover some bloated and confusing trade dispute, political mess, all-out war is brewing nonsense.
And the Jedi?
Kill them immediately.
Yes, yes, my lord, as you wish.
Captain, look!
Teal!
Sorry.
Dioxus.
What is going on down there?
We lost the transmission, sir.
Along the way, they pick up a fast-talking and dumb-witted life form, impressively portrayed entirely by CGI and voiced by Ahmed Best. At least, it was impressive when I first saw it 13 years ago. Along their adventure, our heroes encounter bizarre creatures, swindlers, gangsters, cheats, liars, evildoers, fat blubbering reptile people, and a small boy on a desert planet who is supposedly magically gifted in retroactively overexplained invisible superpowers known as the Force. Writer and director George Lucas received critical praise for his accomplishments for the groundbreaking and mind-blowing Star Wars released in 1977. And rightly so. I gave the film a 10 here on Movie Night for a reason. It is a true masterpiece of cinema, and expertly delivers all of the fun and adventure we go to the movies for. Decades later, and unchained by restrictive studio executives or the limits of modern-day visual effects, Lucas set out to create a three-movie backstory to the original film's supervillain, Darth Vader, which is the Phantom Menace's first misstep, building an entirely new trilogy around a character that would have honestly been better off left a mystery. Instead, we're forced to suffer through child actor Jake Lloyd's overly obnoxious and sometimes painfully cringeworthy portrayal of a little boy who shows no signs of ever being the Dark Lord that James Earl Jones famously voiced in the Best Picture-nominated original. With that in mind, it seems as though this prequel was destined to fail, at least in the eyes of diehard fans of the series, as there was simply no way this story, this involved, this confusing and haphazard, would ever truly live up to the success of its influential predecessor. The one marked improvement, however, is undeniably the visual effects, which were earth-shattering in 1999, and with few exceptions, hold up very well today. Thanks to the talented work of Lucas's own film effects powerhouse, Industrial Light and Magic, entire sequences of this movie are carried by computer-animated aliens, robots, and spaceships. Unquestionably, the best example of this, and the de facto centerpiece of this fantasy film, is a Ben-Hur-style, no-holds-barred chariot race on low-flying superspeeders known as pod racing. It's an expertly crafted sequence with great effects, sounds, music, and editing. A thrilling three-person lightsaber duel with the frightening Darth Maul caps off an otherwise mediocre film with a pulse-pounding climax. From the lush landscapes of Naboo to the endless city spires of Metro Planet Coruscant, The Phantom Menace is beaming with imaginative and inspiring visuals. It's just unfortunate they're populated with poorly written characters devoid of logical motivation or purpose. Fans of the original or fans of flashy science fantasy will enjoy this film, if only for the eye candy and explosive action sequences, but don't expect anything in the realm of great acting, writing, pacing, or high art. Now as for the most recent version of this film, the first of all six of them to be retrofitted with post-converted three dimensions, save your money. It adds absolutely nothing to the proceedings, and as with all 3D projections, actually limits the film's brightness by an estimated 20%. Dozens of scenes seemed like they were just left alone in 2D, while the rest of the film barely had any noticeable depth to them, including the pod race, which is perhaps the biggest waste of the entire 3D concept. The Blu-ray box set that came out last fall for $90 is a much better value. The image quality is outstanding, the commentary tracks are interesting and informative, and there's a plethora of great bonus features for longtime fans. Star Wars Episode I: The Phantom Menace. Brilliantly imagined, but poorly executed. Well, those are my extended thoughts on this iconic film. Now let's see what you had to say about the Star Wars prequel in the YouTube comments. Here's a Rate-O-Matic to show us our scores for The Phantom Menace. A 7 and an 8. Lots of mixed and passionate reviews for this film, and I think we all understand why. For many kids, it's an almost rite of passage to fall in love with Star Wars growing up. And we're conditioned to believe that they're all masterpieces, which sadly isn't the case. Many of you cited the bad writing and confusing plot as negatives, and your scores averaged to a great. As the Factor Facts show, I really enjoyed this film. The music and action-packed visuals are definitely exciting and worth the price of admission. But the terrible plot, boring characters, and awkward pacing really hurt this film from reaching the memorable status of the originals. I thought it was cool, though. Now let's take a look at what's currently playing in theaters with some tweet critiques. Remember, if you're going to the movies this weekend, make sure to submit your Twitter review using the JPMN hashtag to have it featured on an upcoming episode. Next week, we'll be reviewing all 9 Best Picture nominees in Movie Night's second annual Oscar special. The Artist, The Descendants, Extremely Loud and Incredibly Close, Hugo, Midnight in Paris, The Tree of Life, War Horse, and a quick revisit of The Help and Moneyball, which we've already reviewed. It's going to be an epic episode, jam-packed with reviews and predictions to get you prepared for the 84th Annual Academy Awards, which airs on February 26th. As always, I encourage you to buy, rent, or download these films, and let me know what you think about them by voting in the polls below or by leaving me a comment review. Once again, my name is Jonathan Paula. Thank you for watching Movie Night. I hope to see you right back here next Friday.